The plan for today's class is to complete this chapter. There's this section on convergence which is left. So you have conditional and unconditional convergence in the solo model. And section 3.5 basically tests the evidences that we have from the world economy. And it tries to see if the results that we get from the solo model are actually witnessed in the world economies or not. So convergence is one important implication that we can get from the solo model. And there are two kinds of convergence concepts that we are going to read. First is the unconditional convergence and the second is the conditional convergence. So what do we really mean by unconditional convergence? Because of this very important assumption in the solo model, that is the law of diminishing returns, it seems that the solo model points to the concept of convergence, because ultimately we see that any kind of improvement that that is brought about in terms of capital is finally sort of culminated in the steady state level of capital per capita, and your growth process tends to converge towards that point of steady state. So at the very heart of the solo model is the implication of convergence. But how do we actually interpret this in terms of development economics and when we try and compare different economies? So unconditional convergence basically say that suppose we hypothetically imagine that different countries have no tendency to display differences in the rates of technical progress, savings, population growth rate, and capital depreciation. These are different factors that we have incorporated in the solo equations, and these are parameters that could bring about a change either in the short run growth of the solo model or the long run growth of the solo model. So suppose we postulate that different countries have the same rates of these parameters, then the solo model predicts that in all countries, in all of these countries who are sharing the same level of these parameters, the capital per efficiency unit of labor, which we had described, which we had introduced in section 3.4. So now we are talking about K star hat, which is capital per efficiency unit of labor, converges to a common value K star hat. So we are saying that if, say, there are three countries and all of these three countries have the same savings rate, same population rate, same depreciation rate, same technical progress rate, then we know that their steady states will also be the same. Their steady states of capital per efficiency labor will also be the same. And hence we can conclude that in the presence of the similar exogenous parameters, irrespective of where the economy starts from, whether it starts from a point below the steady state of capital or above the steady state of capital, ultimately in the long run they will all converge to the same point. And that's the meaning of unconditional convergence, where we start with an assumption of different economies sharing the same level of exogenous parameters, and then we can say that because the parameter values are similar across different countries, their steady state will also be the same. So in a way we are saying that ultimately these economies will converge to the same point of steady state of capital. We can say that history in the sense of different initial condition doesn't matter, because if these economies have the same level of K hat star, then no matter where the economies come from, whether it is a rich economy or a poor economy, doesn't matter. Ultimately in the long run all of these economies will come to the same point. So it is a very strong result that we get, because this sort of tells us that if this is true, if the idea of unconditional convergence is true, then we can imagine that the inequality in the world will be lesser, because ultimately in the long run all of these economies will reach the same point of steady state of capital, and then they will grow at the same rate. So we shouldn't really have economies, such disparities within across economies, and we shouldn't really have this level of inequality that we have in the world today. So graphically, if we have to test this implication, then we are in a way saying this is what we are trying to represent. So on the x-axis, you have time. On the y-axis, you have log per capita income. So these are nothing but the growth rates of per capita income. The slope of these equations, the slope of these graphs, of these lines, will tell you the growth rate. So AB is the time trend, is the time path for the growth rate of capital, steady state of capital per efficiency unit labor. CD is the time path of a country that starts from below the steady state level of capital. So suppose this is the star hat value. You have one economy whose k hat value is less than k star hat value, and another economy capital per efficiency unit labor value is greater than k star value. So AB here represents the time path of these countries when they reach the k star hat value, which is constant, because once you reach k star hat value, you know that the growth rate is equal to pi. So then AB grows at pi. AB, basically the slope of AB, is nothing but pi. CD represents this country which has capital per efficiency unit labor less than the steady state value, and EF represents a country which has a steady state, which has a capital per efficiency unit labor greater than the steady state value. Now we know that from the theory, we know that if an economy starts from below the steady state level of capital per capita value, then the economy will grow at a higher rate. Initially, it will grow at a higher rate. The farther it is from the steady state value, the higher will be the growth rate. So you notice that initially in the time axis, the slope of this path is steeper than the slope of AB path, and then as the capital value reaches close to the steady state value, the growth rate tends to converge with the growth rate of the steady state value. So ultimately, once you reach this, once you reach closer to this point, the growth rate will become parallel to AB, or it will sort of converge with AB. EF is a country which has capital per efficiency labor greater than the steady state value. So again, from the theory, we know that if you start from a point which is to the right of the steady state value, then initially your growth rate will tend to sort of fall, because now you are at a point where diminishing returns to factor has been set, and now there will be a reduction in the capital per capita with each passing time period. So the slope of the EF tends to be flatter than that of AB, and ultimately ultimately with each time period, the path EF will converge with the path AB. So as from K2 hat you come closer to K star hat, the growth rates will converge, the time path will converge to that of AB. So you will reach the steady state value, which is the same for both these countries, whether you are a poor country meaning you start from capital per capita value less than the steady state value, or you are a rich country, which is what is represented by path EF. No matter where you start from, you will ultimately follow this path, which is the path of AB, because you have the same steady state value of capital per efficiency labor. Now from this graph, we can also say that if we have to test this, if we have to test whether countries are really following unconditional convergence or not, we can check the following. So we notice that countries which are poorer, they tend to grow at a higher rate as compared to countries which are richer. So CD is the time path for a country which is poorer because it starts from a lesser capital stock value. So we notice that because it is to the left of the steady state value of capital per efficiency labor, it tends to grow at a higher rate as compared to country EF, which starts from a higher value of capital and the growth rate of this country is lesser. So we can say the implication of this graph can be that countries, poorer countries tend to grow at a higher rate as compared to the richer countries. So we can say that there's an inverse relationship between the growth rate of income and the level of income. Level of income will tell us whether a country is poor or rich. So if a country has a lesser level of per capita income, it tells us that it is a poor country. And growth rate will tell us the percentage at which this level is changing with each passing time period. So we are saying that for unconditional convergence to occur, to take place, it is important that poorer countries need to grow at a faster rate as compared to richer countries, because it is only then that it would be possible for poorer countries to catch up with the growth rate of the richer countries, because obviously richer countries are already endowed with larger capital stock, and unconditional convergence says that all of these economies have they share, whether poor or rich, since they share the same level of exogenous parameters, they will have the same level of capital, steady state of capital per efficiency labor. So ultimately all of them will reach the same point, and for all of them to reach the same point, it is important for the poorer countries to grow at a much faster rate so that they can catch up and reach the point of the richer countries. So one implication that we can get from this graph is that there is a strong negative relationship between growth rates of per capita income and initial value of per capita income. Is this point clear? That for unconditional convergence to hold true, this is a test that we can attempt to take from different world economies and see if they satisfy this relationship or not. And if the countries tend to satisfy this relationship, then we can say that the solo model or the implications of solo model are actually taking place in reality as well. Shin basically discusses the evidence or the data that we have from the world around us, and we'll check if the data actually supports the idea of unconditional convergence or not. Now, the problem here is that we don't really have a lot of data backing to the historical time for developing countries, because the collection of data in the developing countries have started only recently. So it is really hard to find examples of reliable data that stretch back to a century or more. So we are going to continue with this section in two ways. The first is to cover a small number of countries over a large period of time, because we don't really have data for a large set of economies for a large period of time. So there's a problem there. So first perspective, first aspect is to look at a small number of countries, but over a large period of time. Then the second way to check for unconditional convergence is to cover a large number of countries, but over a short period of time. So these are the two ways by which we are going to check the existence of unconditional convergence. So we are starting with the first aspect here, which is a small set of countries over a long time horizon. Now, this is a paper by Baumol in 1986. He had examined the growth rates of 16 countries that are amongst the richest in the world today. So he took the growth rates of about 16 countries, and he tried to see if these countries are actually satisfying the unconditional convergence idea or not. The data from this paper, for this paper, was taken from the work of Madison. The data on per capita income was available for these countries for the year 80-70. So what did he really do was a very simple analysis, which we had just checked in the previous section, that he plotted per capita income of these 16 countries for the year 1870 on the x-axis, and on the y-axis he took the growth rates of per capita income again of these 16 countries over the period 1870 to 1979. So what do we expect? So if we have growth rates on the y-axis and the initial level of per capita income on the x-axis, then we expect that there will be some kind of negative relationship, because countries who were poorer in 1870 will have to grow at a much faster rate over the next few years as compared to countries which were richer in 1870 as per the results of unconditional convergence. So he tried to see if these countries, or the data that we get from these 16 countries, whether do they lie on a downward sloping line or not. Indeed, the exercise seemed to pay off very well. The countries did actually follow the downward sloping line, and I'll just show you the graph here. So this is the graph that you get. On the x-axis you have per capita income, y-axis you have the growth rates, and these are the points of these 16 countries. You notice that there is definitely a downward slope that we get from the data here. But there is a big problem here, which is what we are going to discuss next. So it seemed at the first that there seems to be existence of unconditional convergence in the economies, because if we compare these economies, these 16 economies which are now the rich, one of the richest economies, these economies that Baumol had taken in his paper are as follows. They are categorized, they are ordered from poorest to richest in 1870. So in 1870, these economies, the following 16 economies were taken, and they are ordered from the poorest economy to the richest economy. So Japan was one of the poorest economies in 1870, Finland, Sweden, Norway, Germany, Italy, Austria, and so on. The richest being UK, Belgium, Australia in 1870. But in 1979, we see that the poorer economies like Japan or Finland were actually growing at a much faster rate as compared to economies such as US or UK or Australia, which is what we had seen from the Baumol's analysis. But the countries in the Madison data set, because Baumol had used this Madison data set, these countries had very comparable per capita incomes in 1979, but they had widely different levels of per capita income in 1870. So definitely we see some kind of convergence because these economies had different incomes. Wide disparities were there in terms of their incomes in 1870, but there were much lesser disparities in 1979 because of the idea of convergence. Now, in opposition to this paper, De Long in 1988, this paper, the Baumol's paper, was introduced in 86, and in 88, De Long carried out the same analysis, and again he plotted the same kind of analysis was conducted by De Long as well, and he did verify that the analysis that Baumol had done was correct, and he did see that there was a negative downward sloping trend. But he identified one major very basic statistical pitfall that Baumol had conducted in his study, which was that Baumol only considered countries which were rich ex post. That is, he only took countries which were sharing similar levels of income in 1979. So basically he took two time periods, 1870 and 1979, and he saw whether between these two time periods economies who were poorer in 1870, whether they had grown at a higher rate between 1870 and 1979. But the problem was that he made a selection bias. And how did he introduce his selection bias? Is by only taking rich countries in 1979. Because this paper was published in 86, he obviously knew that which were the countries who were richer in 1979 and who had similar levels of income in 1979. So he only took countries which had similar per capita GDP levels in 1979. But in 1870, with no knowledge of the future, what criteria would have told us that which of these countries ex ante would test convergence down the road? So he took Japan in his sample, right? We just saw the list of countries that were included. So he definitely took Japan in his sample, but Japan in 1870 was not different from economies like Argentina, Chile or Portugal. So his idea is, DeLong's contradiction to Baumol's paper is that if he took Japan in his sample, why didn't he take Argentina or Chile or Portugal? Because if he would have taken these countries in his sample, then he wouldn't have seen the same kind of trend that he witnesses in his set of 16 countries sample. Because the reason being that he had only taken countries which did follow the results of Solow model ex post, but the a proper test of this implication would have been to pick countries which looked like they would converge in 1870. So the idea was to take up countries which looked that they would converge, but that conditioning should have been placed in 1870 and not in 1979. So the results that we get, the idea of convergence that we tend to believe from the Baumol study, has actually come out from a statistical irregularity rather than from some kind of underlying theory. There is no DeLong claims that there is no theory that we actually see here, but it is just a result of statistical irregularity. So a true test of convergence would have been to look at a set of countries ex ante which seemed likely to converge to high per capita GDP levels that came to characterize the richest nation several decades later. So it would not be fair to claim that the poorer nations of Asia or Africa displayed such potential then, but a whole host of countries, many in Europe and some in Latin America, all of which were left out in Baumol study, were very much in the same position as many of these countries which were included in the Madison set of 16. So he is just trying to point out that countries which looked that they would grow later on in 1870 should have been included in the sample of Baumol's set of 16 countries which were sort of excluded. He only took countries which actually growed between 1870 to 1979, and he ignored countries which shared the same probability as that of say a country like Japan but were not included in his sample. So this is a problem of selection bias, and because of this selection bias we tend to sort of get this mirage that the countries are actually following the unconditional hypothesis of unconditional convergence. So DeLong addressed this question further in 1988 by extending the set of these countries, and he introduced these additional countries. So he introduced Argentina, which looked similar as Japan in 1870 and which looked that it would grow because it seemed that these countries would sort of converge later on. So he extended the sample, the Baumol sample, by incorporating these countries. He introduced Argentina, Chile, East Germany, Ireland, New Zealand, Portugal and Spain. Three of these countries, New Zealand, Argentina and Chile, figure in the list of top 10 recipients of British and French overseas investment at that point of time, as late as 1913. So it was believed that investors' faith in these economies reflected a very favorable position for these economies. So he definitely wanted to include these economies as well, because they had the same prospect of growth as that of Japan at that point of time. So when he introduces these economies in the sample, the figure changes to, so now we notice these squares that you see are the new economies, these diamond shapes are the previous economies that were introduced in the Baumol study, and now we see that the downward line sort of gets mixed up, we don't really see a very clear downward trend here in the results. And so DeLong's confirms, DeLong's paper confirms that there is really no existence of unconditional convergence that we see in the world economy. The results that we get from the Baumol's paper was just were just mere results of statistical irregularity and not really some kind of theory that we see in reality. Baumol also sort of did a regression on the growth rates of these economies and on the levels of income in 1870. And he did see that the coefficients, he took the he regressed the log difference in per capita income between 1870 and 1979, which will give you the growth rates of these economies. He regressed this variable on the log of 1870 per capita income and a constant. So he basically wanted to also test this econometrically, and he did see that the slope coefficient was negative, but the coefficient wasn't significant and the goodness of fit was bad. So the R square value was bad, and it did not really give you a good econometric model. He also argued, DeLong also argued, that the 1870 data contained large measurement errors relative to 1979, and because of which it is possible that the observations are more scattered in 1870 than they actually should have been. So, which in that case, the idea of convergence would look inflated, because if in because of measurement errors, if in 1870 economies have high disparities, and in 1979 that disparity comes close, I mean that gets reduced, or economies come closer to each other, then the idea of convergence would get inflated, not because the theory is in place, but because there are measurement errors in 1870 and not in 1979. So he also tried to counter that, and he tried to reduce the measurement errors in 1870. And then when he regressed the data after correcting for the measurement errors, he saw that the slope coefficient comes out to be close to zero, which indicates that there was negligible systematic relationship between a country's growth rate and its per capita, at least in the cross section of 22 countries that he saw. So this is the result that we have from the unconditional convergence on the first aspect, which is a small set of countries over a large period of time. The other aspect to check for unconditional convergence is to look at a large set of countries over a shorter time period. Now, by using a large set of countries, the approach has an advantage of smoothing out possible statistical irregularities that we had when we were looking at a small sample, primarily because of the statistical law of large numbers. So if you have larger economies, and any kind of trend that you see when you have a large sample is something that can be believed to hold true universally as well for the population as well. So we can't really make any population level judgments from the previous analysis, which was on a shorter sample, but we can definitely make a universal analysis, or can be more assured of the results that we get when we have a large set of countries, because it will smooth out any kind of statistical irregularity in the data. But the disadvantage is that we had to shorten the time span, because the data isn't available for these large set of economies over a larger time period. So in chapter 2, we had used the Summers-Heston data set. If you remember the ICP program, when we were talking about the purchasing power parity, we had referred to this data set. And the data set basically looked at how the world distribution of income has changed over the period 1965 to 85. If you look at the same data set, if you also remember, we also did a mobility matrix. So from the same data, we can say that the gap between richest and the poorest countries haven't really seemed to narrowed down, with per capita GDP expressed as a fraction of US level in the same year, a plot of the average for the five richest and the five poorest nations over this 26-year period will display a more or less constant relative gap between them. Because if there is some kind of convergence that is occurring in the world economy, then we will believe this gap to narrow down. But we, from the data, from the Summer Session data set, we see that the gap is more or less the more or less constant over the same time period. And it isn't that the gap between the richest or the poorer nations have sort of narrowed down. So from that, we refute the idea of any kind of convergence that we see amongst the world economies. With this, we are not meaning to say that the poorer countries have not moved up in absolute terms. The average per capita income of the poorer economies have increased, but the relative incomes have stayed the same because they are growing at the same rate as that of the richest economies. So it is not that the poorer economies haven't, there is no growth in poorer economies. That's not true. The poorer economies are definitely growing. Their levels of, average levels of per capita income have increased between these time periods. But relative to US or relative to the developed nations, they are growing at the same rate. Because the unconditional convergence would believe that the poorer countries are growing at a higher rate. But we don't really see that kind of results from the data on the Summers-Heston's data set. Another evidence that we have is from another study, which is Parent and Prescott by 1993. In 1993, they studied 102 countries over the same time period, 1960 to 85, and in this study they converted each country's per capita real GDP in relative terms, basically a fraction of US per capita GDP for the same year. So for each of the years between 1960 to 1985, these 102 countries, their income were converted into relative income with respect to the US income for that particular year. And then the author had calculated the standard deviation of these values separately for each year. So say you have 102 countries. For each of these countries, you have for say 1960, you are converting the income of these 102 countries into relative incomes. Relative income would indicate the fraction of their income with respect to the US income. So you basically divide the country's income with the US income for the year 1960, and similarly you do repeat the same thing for 1961, 1962, and so on till 1985. And then the author had calculated the standard deviation of these relative incomes for each year. So for 1960, once you convert the incomes of 102 countries into their relative incomes, then you look at the standard deviation of these incomes for each year. And what would you expect if the convergence hypothesis was taking place? You will expect that the countries would move closer to each other in income levels, and we would expect that the standard deviation of their relative incomes will fall over time. So between 1960 to 1985, we can believe that the standard deviation of income will fall. But in the Parent and Prescott study, we see that it actually increased by 18.5% over the 26 period. And the increase was fairly uniform from year to year. Although there were some variations if you look at some geographical clusters. So if you look at the incomes of Western European countries, you will show a clear decline. Meaning that within this geographical cluster of Western Europe, the countries were actually coming closer to each other. But if you apply the same thing to Asian countries, then you will find a pronounced increase. And in fact, a divergence in this region will be noticed. So if you look at the overall data, if you look at the entire set of 102 countries, you see that the standard deviation of relative incomes from each year have actually increased. So that sort of contradicts the idea of unconditional convergence, because unconditional convergence would believe that the countries' income are relative incomes are coming closer to each other, and there is lesser standard deviation with each passing time period. To summarize, we can say that we know that the Haro-Domar model in its very simple form predicts that there is neutrality of growth rates with respect to per capita income. And now I think the idea of neutrality will also become clearer now, because we've discussed Solo model. So you can sort of relate to the kind of different implications that we have from the Solo and the Haro model. the Solow model says that with the changes in, it says that the growth rates will be different for different levels of income. So say an economy is richer, then we expect the growth rate of this economy to be lesser as compared to an economy which is poorer. So in the Solow model, we sort of build some kind of relationship between the growth rates vis-a-vis the level of income, whereas the Harrod-Domar model is neutral, and that's why we say that it sort of predicts the neutrality of growth rates with respect to per capita income. We don't really have any kind of implication from the Harrod model which sort of relates the poorer or the richer nations, and it sort of differs them in terms of how they should grow in the future. So Harrod-Domar model in its simplest form predicts the neutrality of growth rates, but because of the assumptions that the returns to capital are constant, parameters such as the savings rate have growth rate effects, whereas per capita income plays no role to speed up or slow down the pace of growth. The major difference between the Harrod-Domar and the Solow model is that the former assumes returns to capital are constant, whereas the Solow model assumes that the returns to capital are not constant. In fact, they are diminishing. And that's why the kind of implications you get from the Solow model are different. But the prediction of the Solow model, they seemed to be clearly rejected by the data. At least the idea of unconditional convergence seems to be clearly rejected by the data. It follows that the simple version of the Solow model is not valid. But we have learned something, because the Solow model can be treated as a benchmark form which we can from which we can explore different truths. Our task then is to examine several directions of reconciliation between the theory and the data, and in so doing to learn new ways to look at the data. In closing this section, we can dispose of a simple objection first. We could say that the simple Harrod-Domar model was right after all. It predicts the neutrality of growth rates with respect to per capita income. That is what we seem to get by and large from the evidences that we have just inspected. But the main rejoinder, but then why are we actually studying the Solow model if we say that there is in fact neutrality of growth rates with respect to per capita income? The main rejoinder to this point is the assumption of constant returns to physical capital alone. The major difficulty in accepting the Harrod model is the assumption of constant returns to physical capital alone, which we can't really believe in reality to take place, because we know that there will be, physical capital would need labor to operate, and we are far from a world of pure automation where physical capital can work by itself. So we cannot really accept the assumption of constant returns to physical capital alone, and that is the reason why we also can't rely on Harrod-Domar alone, irrespective of the fact that it seems that there is some sort of neutrality of growth rates with respect to per capita income that we tend to get from the results of Solow model as well. But Harrod-Domar model has its own issues, and by far from the discussion so far, Solow model also seems to have its issues in terms of not theoretically, but when we try and match it with the data, with the empirics, we see that there is not much relationship, much reconciliation between the data and the theory of the Solow model. So what is it that really explains the growth process and that sort of matches with the trends that we see in empirics in the data is what we are searching for. And in the subsequent discussions, not just for the Solow model, but also when we talk about the endogenous growth theories, which extend the discussion to what exactly is technical progress in the Solow model, we'll understand what we really try to mean when we talk about growth theories in the context of the world economy. So the next topic that we have is on conditional convergence. If you remember, when we were talking about unconditional convergence, one assumption that we had made was that across all countries, we assume that the level of technical knowledge, the rate of depreciation, the savings rate, the population growth rate, we assumed all of these parameters to be the same. This notion certainly flies in the face of the facts, because countries differ in many ways, and it's not possible that all of these features of these countries will stay the same.
So although this has no effect on the basic prediction of the Solow model that countries tend to converge to their steady states, but now we are saying under the context of conditional convergence, we are saying that countries can now differ in terms of their steady states. So different countries can have different steady states because these countries will have different savings rate or population growth rates or the depreciation rates. But one thing that we assume in conditional convergence that stays common is the rate of technical progress. So we are saying that now countries can have different steady states. So there is no need for two countries to converge to each other. As in the previous case, we were expecting that the countries will converge to the same steady state value. We are now saying that countries will now converge, but now they will converge to their own steady state values, which will be calculated based on the parameter values existent in the country. But we are assuming, we are still keeping the assumption intact that knowledge feels flows freely across countries, so that technical know-how is the same for all countries, but we allow all other parameters such as the savings rate and the population growth rates to be different across countries. So we are saying that technical progress or PI is the same across different countries, but all other parameters such as the savings rate, depreciation, population, etc. are different in different countries. So conditional convergence basically says that the growth rate, we know that in the Solow model, long run growth rate is determined entirely by the rate of technical progress. Long run growth rate in per capita income is only explained by technical progress, and we are assuming this to be the same across different countries because we believe that there is a free flow of knowledge or free flow of information from one country to another country. So rate of technical progress ultimately will tend to be the same across different countries, and hence under the context of conditional convergence, we are saying that there will be convergence in growth rates, not in the level of steady state value of capital. So this is the basic difference between unconditional and conditional convergence. In unconditional convergence, we were trying to predict, the idea predicted that the countries will converge to the same steady state level of per capita capital per efficiency labor units. But now in conditional convergence, we are saying that this value can be different for different countries, but the rate at which these countries will grow, which is the rate of technical progress, will be same. So we are saying that there will be convergence in growth rates, which is the long run per capita growth rate of all countries, will be predicted to be the same under the context of conditional convergence. So again, graphically, by the time paths, how can we represent the idea of conditional convergence is as follows. So we have two time paths. Again, you have on the y-axis, you have log per capita income. On the x-axis, you have time. And here you have AB and A prime B prime as two steady state time paths. So AB is the time path of a country which has a lesser steady state value as compared to A prime B prime, but both AB and A prime B prime represent the time path of countries at the steady state value of capital. Now imagine that for this country, which is a poorer country, because you know that the level, you can see that the level of per capita income for this country is lesser as compared to this country. So we are now comparing the country's actual growth path with that of the steady state growth path. Remember, AB and A prime B prime are the steady state growth path. So imagine that this country starts, the poorer country starts from a value of per capita income that is greater than the steady state value of per capita income. So the initial level of capital stock in this economy is greater than the steady state value. So then the time path will be flatter initially as compared to the slope of the steady state growth path, and ultimately it will converge to the same growth path because it will come closer to the steady state value of capital per efficiency labor. On the other hand, this country, which is a richer country, it starts, imagine that it starts from a point below the steady state value of capital. So the time path will look something like that, represented here by line EF, because since it is to the left of the steady state value of capital per efficiency labor, it will initially tend to have a higher growth rate, and ultimately as it comes closer to the steady state value, the growth rate will sort of decrease and it will converge to the growth path at the steady state value, which is represented by A prime B prime. So these will be the time paths of these two economies, and we are assuming that the poorer economy starts to the right of the steady state value and the richer economy starts to the left of the steady state value, and this is what we get. Now you will notice that one thing that you will notice here is that time path AB and A prime B prime are parallel to each other, which is what the idea of conditional convergence is. As I explained in the last graph as well, that the slope of these lines are nothing but the growth rates, because the slope will basically give you del log per capita income divided by d log t. That is nothing but the, what is it? It is the percentage change in the output, percentage change in per capita income with respect to the percentage change in time. That is nothing but the growth rate. So these, the slope of A prime B prime and the slope of AB is nothing but the growth rate, and in conditional convergence we assume that the growth rates are same, because we assume that the value of pi or the rate of technical progress is the same across countries. So you first thing that you notice here is that these two are parallel to each other, but these two also have their own steady state values. So this one has a smaller steady state value, this one has a larger steady state value, but once economies reach their steady state values, their long run growth rates are constant or similar. Another thing that you will notice here is something that goes against the results from the unconditional convergence. So in unconditional convergence, we said that poorer countries will tend to grow faster than richer countries. We saw that coming from the graph itself. But if you look at the graph here, we actually get an opposite result. We said that this is a poorer country because obviously it has a lesser level of income as compared to this country. So we say that ideally, if we had to believe the, I mean, if we had to follow the same results from the unconditional convergence, this country should have grown at a higher rate as compared to EF, because EF is a richer country. But we see an opposite trend. We see that country CD grows at a lesser rate as compared to country EF. This country is a poorer country. CD is the time path of a poorer country and EF is the time path of a rich country. But CD has a lesser growth rate despite being a poorer country, and EF has a higher growth rate despite being a richer country, which is opposite to the results that we had derived for unconditional convergence. So CD is growing at a lesser growth rate, whereas EF is growing at a higher growth rate. Ideally, from the unconditional convergence, we should have got opposite results. So again, conditional convergence doesn't really imply that there will be a negative relationship between growth rates and the level of, or the initial level of, per capita income for economies, because it depends on where these economies start from. So because this is a conditional convergence, the name itself tells you that the convergence the convergence in this case is conditional on the level of steady state value, and depending on where the initial point is, the convergence is conditioned on that. So if the poorer economy was starting from a point to the left of the steady state value, then you would have got the same results as that of unconditional convergence, because then you would have got a curve looking like this. But because in our example, we are assuming that the poorer country is starting from a point above the steady state value, you get a lesser growth rate. But imagine the poorer country was below the steady state value and the richer country was above the steady state value, then you would have got the same results as you had got in the unconditional hypothesis. But we do not get, I mean, it's not unambiguously true that there will be a negative relationship between growth rates and the initial level of per capita income from the conditional convergence. It totally depends on the steady state value for the different economies and the initial level of capital per capita for these economies. Growth rates convergence, growth rate convergence or conditional convergence, both of them mean the same thing, because conditional convergence is nothing but growth rate convergence. So conditional convergence or growth rate convergence implies that a country which is below its own steady state grows faster than its steady state growth rate. But to test this, we have to also use the data to identify where these steady states are. To test this possibility, we need to condition or we need to sort of control for the level of these steady states. For this reason, unconditional convergence is really an unconditional hypothesis. Asserting that all the steady states are in the same place obviates the need to condition for the positions of different steady states. Because in unconditional hypothesis, we didn't have to worry about the positions of steady states, because we assumed that in unconditional hypothesis, the steady states were all the same. So to be able to test for conditional convergence, we will first have to control for the different positions of steady states, right? So in the conditional convergence case, we need to condition or control for the level of steady states for different countries. The idea of controlling for the position of steady states amounts to factoring out the effects of parameters that might differ across countries and then examining whether convergence occurs. So these two last paragraphs are actually important for understanding how do you actually test for conditional convergence. So as we are saying that in unconditional convergence, we didn't really have to bother about the differences in the level of steady states, because we assumed that all the steady states for all the countries are going to be at the same level. But since in conditional convergence, we believe that these steady state values are different, we first need to control or condition for the differences in the steady states across countries. Now to do so, we have to factor out the effects of parameters that might differ. Now, parameters are basically the factors that are controlling for differences in the steady state, such as the savings rate or the population growth rate or the depreciation rate. So we need to factor out the effects of parameters that might differ across countries and then examine whether convergence occurs or not. Such a concept is called as conditional convergence, because we are controlling on possible inter-country differences before we examine the possibility of convergence. So that is the reason why we call this as conditional convergence, because we are accounting for the fact that countries are different, that the parameters are different across countries, parameters such as savings rate, population rate, or the depreciation rate, these are all different across countries, and we are controlling or conditioning for these parameters, and then we are checking whether there is any kind of convergence in the growth rates across different countries or not. Then we move on to the last section of this chapter, which is re-examining the data. Now, this is some econometric modeling that is being done to understand and to test whether the results that the theory suggests, are they being actually whether they are getting verified from the data that we have in reality. So this is some re-examination of the data. To apply notions of conditioning properly to the data, it is important to see in more detail what the theory is trying to tell us. And to be able to do so, we begin by solving for steady state K star hat in the SOLO model with technical progress. What follows looks like a little complicated. To make it easier, I'll tell you where we are heading. So we are going to find what we are really going to do in this section is, and then the author is slightly giving you a caution that the following analysis looks slightly complicated, but the idea of the analysis is to find a relationship between per capita income and various parameters such as savings rate, population growth rate that we can estimate with the data. So using the theoretical equations, we are going to build an econometric model, and then we are going to test that econometric model with the data from different countries that we have at hand. So to solve for the steady state, this is the final equation that we have with technical progress in the model. And if you rearrange this equation, you will get this equation. So basically, you are taking
K star on one hand. So if you take all the K star terms on one hand and then just take the ratio of K star Y star, this is what you'll get. This is just a mere simplification of this equation. And using the approximation the approximation rule, we are just getting rid of the brackets, as we say that these parameter values are going to be very small. So when you open this bracket out, the product of the parameters are ignored in the approximation in equation 3.13, because we say that the product of two small numbers will even be smaller. So we are ignoring, when you open the bracket, we are ignoring parameters such as n into pi. And we say that k star by y star will be approximately equal to this ratio, which is s by n plus pi plus delta. Now, to be able to go further, we must relate output to capital input more precisely. So we are taking a specific production function in this case, and that being a Cobb-Douglas production function. I hope all of you know what a Cobb-Douglas production function looks like. So this is the kind of production function we are talking about, which is y is equal to k raised to the power alpha, l raised to the power 1 minus alpha. You can convert this into effective labor form. So you are basically, L basically represents, L here represents E into P. So L is nothing but effective labor. So we are dividing both sides by L and converting it into per capita, we are converting into per effective labor form, and that gives us, so we are basically converting this Cobb-Douglas production function into Y hat K hat form. And this is what we get. Y hat is equal to K hat alpha. And again, just rearrangement of the same, we get the value for k hat by y hat. And how do you get that? So from this equation, you can say that k hat is equal to, sorry, I missed on the hats here. So k hat is equal to y hat raised to the power 1 by alpha. From this equation, I can say, I can write the first equation here, and then I'm just taking y hat, dividing both sides by y hat. So I will get k hat by y hat is equal to y hat raised to the power 1 by alpha minus 1, because I'm dividing it by y hat. So this is what I'll get. K hat by y hat is equal to y hat raised to the power 1 minus alpha by alpha. Right? Moving ahead. And if you remember, in the last equations, we had looked at this specification from the theory. So k hat y hat is equal to s by n plus pi plus delta. So we are just sort of substituting, equating these two equations, right? So if k star y hat, if k hat y hat is equal to this, then k star hat, y star hat for this production function will be equal to this. We have just taken the k star y star hat value from here, and we have just substituted the same here in this equation for this production function, and this is what you get. Y star hat is roughly equal to s by n plus g plus delta divided raised to the power alpha upon 1 minus alpha. And g, I think it should be pi. There is some error here. This shouldn't be g, this should be pi. So just correct that. This has to be pi. Now if you convert this into log form, then you're taking log both sides. So you will have on the left side log y star hat. And you know that when you take the log of an exponent, you basically multiply the exponent with the terms here. And again, since this is getting divided, the denominators will come in the subtraction form. So you will have alpha upon 1 minus alpha log of s minus alpha upon 1 minus alpha log of this entire term, n plus pi plus delta. Finally, we are rewriting y star pi in terms of per capita form, which is something that we can observe directly from the data. So right now, this is y star hat, meaning that this is output per effective labor. Now what we are writing, we are converting this into per capita form, which is y plus y capital Y divided by p, And we are doing this because to match with the data, because ultimately we are going to, in this econometric model, we are going to fit the model with the data. So we don't really have data on Y hat. You don't really get any data which is represented in the form of output per effective labor. From the data, we can only get output per capita. So we need to convert this into a form for which we can get the data. So we are converting Y hat into small y. So we know that LT is nothing but a product of ET and PT, where PT is the population and ET is the efficiency. We can also say, because we know that ET grows at the rate of pi, which is the rate of technical progress. So we can also say that ET plus 1 is equal to 1 plus pi times ET. So Y star hat can be written as capital YT divided by PT into ET. And now we are just replacing ET with this term. So ET can be written as E naught, which is the first time period, into 1 plus pi times t. This is just how you write the growth rate equation. So capital YT by PT will become small yt, and the denominator will be left, which is E naught. That is technical knowledge as at some baseline date, some benchmark baseline initial time period. And T is counted in terms of years elapsed from the baseline date. So T, basically small t, represents the number of times, number of years from the baseline year till the current year. And this is the equation that we get. Again, we are taking log on both sides. So when we take the log on both sides, it becomes log Y star hat is equal to log Y T minus log E naught minus T times log 1 plus pi. And now we are just using this relationship between log Y star hat and these terms, and we are just substituting these terms on in 3.14, replacing this log Y star hat with this term. So what will we get? We'll get log yt minus log e naught minus t log 1 plus pi on the left side. And we are taking these two terms on the right hand side, because these are nothing but constants. So we will take them on the right hand side, and we have summarized them in this term A. So A is nothing but a collection of these terms, log of e naught and t into log 1 plus pi. Then the rest of the equation is just copied from here, which is 3.14, which is alpha upon 1 minus alpha log s minus alpha upon 1 minus alpha log of n plus pi plus delta. So ultimately, with these complicated mathematical switching here and there, we see that ultimately in 3.15, we get a relationship between output or income per capita and the parameters that are affecting income per capita. Equation that we get by substituting Y star hat and converting it into YT, this is what we get. And we see that we get a positive coefficient here for S. The idea is to understand how really is the level of income per capita affected by different parameters. So we see that small s, which is the savings rate, tends to have a positive effect on income per capita. And that's obvious from the solo understanding that as there is an increase in the savings rate, there will be an increase in the per capita steady state value, and that will further increase the per capita income, level of per capita income. So that is what we see here. The other term that you have here is a negative term, and the parameters associated with the negative term are population growth rate, technical progress, and the depreciation rate. So okay. So now the plan basically is to get data on YT, savings rate, and all of these parameters to be able to estimate this equation 3.15. And we observe that the intercept term A is an unknown from the point of view of the regression exercise, because we are not really interested in these parameters log E naught and T log 1 plus pi. So what we are really interested in understanding these two coefficients, which is the coefficient, the first is the coefficient of log s, and the other is the coefficient of log n plus technical progress plus depreciation rate. Now
one thing that we observe here is that the coefficients of these two terms are actually similar in magnitude. This is alpha 1 minus alpha. This is also alpha upon 1 minus alpha. So for both these parameters, we see that the coefficients are equal, are similar in terms of magnitude, which is what we get from the theoretical modeling. But what do we really get from the econometric estimation is important to see and verify if we really get the same results as we get from the theoretical modeling. Alpha here is, if you remember that we started with a Cobb-Douglas production function, and alpha is nothing but a coefficient on the capital in the production function, and it mirrors the importance of capital in the production process. A rough estimate for alpha has been found by looking at the share of capital in national income, and it turns that it is about 1/3. So therefore, keeping alpha is equal to 1/3, this ratio of alpha upon 1 minus alpha should be around 0.5. Again, these are all theoretical predictions. What do we really get from the econometric results is something that has to be verified with the theoretical predictions. The theoretical prediction is that this value of alpha upon 1 minus alpha should be 0.5. So in a way, what we are really saying is that if this has to be plus 0.5 and this has to be minus 0.5 as per the results that we have from the theory. Hence, we enter the empirical study with the following expectations. The first expectation is that the coefficient on the term log S is positive, and the coefficient on the term log N plus pi plus delta is negative. This captures the solo prediction that savings has a positive level effect on the per capita income, and population growth rate has a negative level effect on the per capita income. Estimated coefficients have to be of the same magnitude, and the magnitude has to be somewhere close to 0.5. Mankiw, Romer and Wheel tested these predictions using the Heston-Summer data set. So the same model 3.15 equation was being tested by using data from Heston-Summers, and they took technical progress plus depreciation to be approximately equal to 0.05. They used the average of investment GDP ratios over the period 1965-85 to form an estimate of the savings rate. So investment GDP ratios were being used during the same period as when the Heston-Summers data set was recorded to get an estimate of the savings rate for different economies. The variable Y was given by per capita GDP in the year 1985. And by using these results, we get the following predictions from the model, from the regression model now. Now, more than half of the worldwide variation in per capita GDP in 1985 can be explained by two variables, S and N. The correlation coefficient of the regression comes out to be 0.59, I think. This is a powerful finding. So now this is a correlation coefficient of the regression that comes out to be 0.5, which means that 50% of the variation in GDP is explained by two variables, savings rate and population growth rate, which is a powerful finding. But again, notice that it is just 50% of the total variation in GDP that is being explained. The rest of the 50% is still unanswered, and that goes in the residual error term, and we still need to find what is it that the rest of the 50% is being explained by. As predicted, the coefficient is for log S turns out to be positive, and the coefficient for the other parameters turns out to be significant and negative. This is in line with the expectation from the theoretical model. And the coefficients too large to be anywhere close to 0.5. So the theoretical prediction was that alpha upon 1 minus alpha should be equal to 0.5, but we do not really get these values. The coefficients on savings turns out to be 1.42, which is much larger than 0.5. And the population parameter turns out to be minus 1.97. Which is again very large, very farther away from 0.5. Also, you don't see that the coefficient on the two terms are similar to each other in magnitude, but theoretically they should have been, because we just saw that they are equal to alpha upon 1 minus alpha. The only difference is that they differ in the terms of their sign. But we in empirics, the data that we get from the regression exercise points to the fact that they are not of similar magnitudes. In fact, population growth rates seem to have a larger depressive effect, because it is
the magnitude of the population coefficient is larger as compared to that of savings. So it signifies that the population growth rates tend to have a larger depressive effect on per capita income as opposed to the upward effects from the savings rate. Now, this analysis was basically just to sort of close the chapter with some results, some points that we get from the data that we have for the economies from 1965 to 85. And we see that although variations in savings and population growth rates seem to be in the same direction as predicted by the SOLO model, differences in per capita income that are actually observed across countries are too large relative to those predicted by the theory. Meaning that we just saw that it is only about 0.5, that means that it's about close to 50% of the variation in the GDP that is being explained by the parameters savings rate and population growth rate. But the actual variation that you observe in the GDP is much larger, and the parameters or the theory is not able to explain the total variation that we see in the GDP, which means that the theory doesn't fairly explain the total variation in the GDP. So there is definitely something that we are missing out in the SOLO model that is explaining the rest of the variation in the GDP across countries. The large observed differences in per capita income suggest that there is little or no diminishing returns to capital. The Harrod-Domar, because of this assumption of little or no diminishing returns to capital, we should have ideally got some kind of convergence, some kind of closeness in terms of per capita GDP level. But from the data, we don't really see anything of that sorts happening. So it seems, again, these are all, I mean, hypothesis that we are building on. We will further look into the endogenous growth theories to suspect what could be the actual reasons for the results that we are getting from the regression equations that were being estimated. So we say that the large observed differences in the per capita incomes across different countries, it sort of gives us a hint that there is actually no diminishing returns to capital. Because if there would have been diminishing returns to capital, then the economies would have come closer to each other in terms of per capita income. So in that situation, the Harrod model seems to be a better choice. But again, at the same time, we cannot buy the fact that there are constant returns to scale in physical capital alone. This is a point that I had stressed earlier as well, that although Harrod model sort of matches with the data, empirical data, in the sense that there is neutrality of growth rates when it comes to comparing it with per capita income, or when it comes to talking about the assumption of diminishing returns to factor. But the very major drawback of the Harrod model is that it assumes that there is constant returns to scale, constant returns to factor, which is again something that cannot be accepted. So there has to be something else that sort of brings these two contradictions together and explains what is the actual reason, what is it that we are missing on in the SOLO and the Harrod-Domar model that actually matches and explains the empirical data. To go on then, we have shown that so far is that once again we drop the assumption that all parameters are the same across countries. The SOLO model does make sense of the data. However, this leads to a different sort of problem. Even though the foregoing exercise may be perfectly satisfactory, don't we owe it to ourselves to understand just why savings rate and population growth rates remain systematically different across countries? Just assuming that this is true is not very satisfactory explanation of what we observe. If we believe that human beings the world over are driven by a common set of economic motivations and that there is no fundamental difference in their genetic desires to save or procreate, then the differences that we do observe may be driven by their particular economic experiences rather than result from some irreconcilable cultural or social differences. This brings us back to the question of endogeneity of these variables. A fuller theory must account for why savings propensities as well as population growth rates are different across countries. So the author is just trying to point out to the fact that since we are all economic agents,
irrespective of whether we stay in a country like India or we stay in a country like US, we still are economic agents. And if we believe ourselves to be rational economic agents, then it is important to understand that why are the savings rate or the population growth rates different across different countries, because ultimately if we are driven by the same set of economic motivations, then ideally there should have been also some convergence in terms of these parameters. But we know that these are different across different countries, so there has to be a fuller theory which sort of explains why these parameters are different. We know that they are different, but to inspect the reasons of why they are different across different countries is also important, and there has to be some explanation of the same. A similar criticism also applies to the assumed exogeneity of technical progress. Although in the Solo model we have a sort of endogenized savings rate and population growth rate, because we sort of explain how they differ with the changes in per capita income, but then the sole parameter that explains the long run growth in the Solo model is assumed to be exogenous. So we are saying that technical progress, which explains the long run growth in the Solo model, is exogenous, and in a way it sort of just replicates the kind of errors that were being done in the Harrod model by assuming the factors that explains the long run growth rate to be exogenous. So the Harrod model assumed savings and population growth rate to be exogenous. Similarly, the Solo model had assumed that the technical progress is exogenous. If so much of the action occurs because of this parameter, then the Solo model, it's important. The question of which forces drive technical progress becomes highly relevant as well. So what is it? What are the factors that explains technical progress, or what are the factors that that impacts technical progress, becomes an important question to dive into. And it is only then we would be able to sort of reconcile the different contradictions that we see from the Harrod and the Solo model. And that has led to newer developments in growth theories. And we will eventually see in chapter 4 when we talk about endogenous growth theories, are the endogenous growth theories able to solve the mysteries or solve the questions that we have, that we are left with by the end of the Solo model as well. So you need to keep all these points in your mind, because when we read chapter 4 of the same book, we will come back to the points raised in chapter 3. We will come back to the results that we have seen from the econometric regression here in this chapter 3 to sort of bring an understanding or bring more clarity to the results that we get from the data so far. So this is the point where I would like to end the discussion on chapter 3 from this book.